Hey guys, I'm Stephen Lowe, the author of Overcoming Gravity, and today we'll be going over Overcoming Gravity Online Part 18, specifically Part 4 Program Implementation, and we move from the untrained beginners into the trained beginners routine construction and implementation, which is Chapter 18. And in this chapter, we'll go through the construction, progression and common modifications, and you'll see that if you watch from the previous video, that you'll see that there are some changes going from untrained to trained, and specifically in regard to what matters and switching from exercises into your specific goals and things like that. So let's get started. So generally for routine construction, the main things to keep in mind is consistency. Obviously, this is important for untrained beginners as well. However, at this point, usually most people will kind of have more of an idea of what tends to work good for them. So, in terms of understanding that maybe full body is a little bit too much for you if you went to a split or maybe you reduced the volume of full body. Basically, you want to find a program that you're able to long-term consistently stick to and not have something like paralysis by analysis, which means you're, thinking about routines all the time and trying to switch them up, or exercise ADHD, like we talked about last time, where you're trying to skip from program to program. So, consistency, especially from the untrained beginners to the trained beginners, is very important, and that's what is going to help build your foundation for the first couple years and later into training, moving into the intermediate, advanced, and beyond skills if you choose to work up towards them. Same with the untrained beginners. Moving into trained beginners, the rep range focus generally will go down into the 5 to 12 rep range, maybe 5 to 10. And this is because we want to start to emphasize more strength and hypertrophy focus, whereas the higher reps like 15 to 20, 12 to 10 to 15, they're useful for learning technique and mitigating a risk of overuse injuries. But in general, once your body gets used to training and your connective tissues have been brought up to speed a bit, you can start doing more specific work in the lower rep ranges, which is good for the mechanical tension and muscle damage related hypertrophy. So similarly, we want to maintain proper balance with pushing and pulling. And this is especially true if you're coming into body weight training from other resistance training. If you're already out of the untrained phase, coming into body weight exercises can put more stress on the connective tissues than with typical weight training. And so balancing the pushing and pulling as well, especially if you're working more beach muscles, is a good idea to understand in this phase. Also, accommodating to training, especially moving into isometrics. For most beginners and untrained beginners specifically, you're mainly working up the basic movements, such as your, push-ups, your dips, your rows, and your pull-ups. In general, most people aren't ready to start the basic progressions of back lever, front lever, and even planche at that time. However, as you moved into the trained beginner phase, which is around, level 4, 5, 6, you actually start to have the strength to start to work some of those beginning progressions. So, we're moving from basically basic exercises into more goal focused things if those are your main goals in the long run. So we're keeping the same sample goals as the last time, and we'll see how that plays out in subsequent routine construction. So warm up and skill is virtually the same. I have various blood flow exercises, get the heart rate up, break out a light sweat, burpees, crawling, jogging, whatever you want to do there. Similarly with mobility, make sure you're doing the joints of focus, so your wrists, your elbows, shoulders, your hips, knees, ankles, your back. Hit all those joints to warm them up. Also, with the connective tissue conditioning with the support holds for 60 seconds, as well as things like German hang and skin the cats, hopefully, if you've moved from the untrained beginner section to the trained beginner, you'll have built up some connective tissue conditioning where you're able to hold the support holds longer and do fewer sets, instead of breaking up in, say, like 6 sets of 10 seconds. And same with the German hang and sand the cats. You should be working those hopefully with less assist with feet on the ground, hopefully moving towards like a tuck or pike skin the cat without any assistance. Likewise, the positional drills, hopefully you're more proficient with those. So anywhere with the 30 to 60 seconds, if you're fine and have good body position with the exercises in your routine, you can start to kind of minimize that. But if you don't, then keep drilling them to learn the body positions. Skill work is also very similar to the untrained beginner. I put in here 5 to 10 minutes of handstands against the wall, but you can usually up that a little bit if you need more practice and a handstand is not as much a strength, just holding yourself up and trying to, work the muscles and have the muscles not fatigue. If you're able to get longer and longer holds, start working it free bouncing away from the wall, but next to the wall. So if your feet are on the wall, start to try to balance it very close to the wall. Same with other specific sports specific skills that you can work on in this phase. All right, so I've divided the strength portion into two sections, more of an isometric focus. So the legs and the core are virtually the same except progressed with the barbells or full single leg squats without assist or weighted step ups and the L-sit moving toward V-sit and weighted reverse hypers. However, the pulls and pushes in this case with the isometric focus, starting to work front lever and back lever in this phase. Likewise, with the pushes, starting to work the tuck or advanced tuck straddle planche. But you can be lower in this phase if you're starting to work like the tuck or advanced tuck in back lever or front lever and frog stand or tuck in planche. So, now, this is just an example of where you might have worked up to in this phase. It could have been the lower progressions starting first. I included the pull-ups or strict muscle-ups in the push section, namely because the muscle-up, if you're working towards muscle-up, the explosive pull-up will help you to work to start to turn over the transition and then into the dip. So if you're working the dip portion of the muscle-up, typically you're getting some pushing movements in there. Likewise, the muscle up itself with the pull and the transition is mostly pull work. So if that doesn't fit in this category for you, or you're not actually close to the muscle up, then you might sub this out for like a dips or a handstand push up variation, or even a pseudo planche push up variation if you wanted to double up on planche work. Though I wouldn't suggest that for a trained beginner. So there are various options you can work on in this specific phase. Does not necessarily mean working up the muscle ups, although most people coming into body training have muscle ups as an aspiration. So that's why I included it there. With more of a bent arm focus, we have rows moving into tuck front lever rows. We have your Y grip or archer pull-ups working towards one arm chin progression. We have our pseudo planche push-ups working towards the planche progression and either ring dips or handstand push-ups working towards, freestanding handstand push-ups. So those are common goals, and these sets of progressions tend to have good transference to other exercises. So this is a commonly recommended exercises for both push and pull with the bent arm focus. Legs and core, same as the previous one, moving up in progressions with either barbells or with the body weight exercises, and same with core. If you have any different exercises that you wanted to work, such as like the natural hamstring curl or Nordic curls, where you're doing the body weight curl, hooking your feet under something and leaning forward and using your legs to pull yourself up, or doing various different core exercises such as, hanging leg raises or ab wheel using the rings. You can do those as well. Doesn't really matter. Generally, rest is similar, three, maybe 5 minutes between sets to maximize strength and hypertrophy here. All right, so this is where prehab, isolation, flexibility, and cooldown can expand a little bit. I included the same as the untrained beginners, but more or less you can add specific exercises as you want. So you can specifically add in things for triceps or delts if you need a little bit more work in those specific areas. Or if you want to do a little bit of prehab, the rice bucket and biceps curls were from the first one. Same with flexibility. I had German hangs and back bridges. But if you have any deficits for any exercises you want to work up towards, such as, say, your straddle planche or straddle back lever or straddle front lever, working on a good straddle is fairly effective. Same with straddle for, straddle press handstand or bent arm. Straight arm and bent arm press handstands, because doing the straddle makes it easier to balance the handstand, and so most progressions will use a straddle first. Same with cooldown. If you want to do a little bit more in cooldown, some people like to add in a jog. I tend to like doing some deep breathing. But all these things you can also include on this day or shift off days if you need more time with them specifically. All right, so this is where most people need help, and it's the progression and leveling up. So I included the previous progressions from the untrained beginner section, which are your linear progression, aka strap more weight onto or make the next exercise easier. The linear repetition progression, which is moving up in the reps, 5 to 15, 5 to 10, anywhere in that range typically works fairly well. Using eccentrics or isometrics to help build up your reps, and then the rest of the simple intra and inter-exercise progressions. So, in the train beginner phase, generally continue easy progressions if you are able. Don't necessarily try to skip to towards periodization, as most people can still progress effectively without it, and skipping to periodization usually underestimates strength gains. So, you're able to easier make strength gains with just doing simple progressions instead of, switching to light heavy, which is a sequential undulating method, or concurrent, which is a DUP or a variation of the concurrence. My main choices for breaking plateaus in this phase are last set to failure. So this helps to decrease fatigue for first couple sets while increasing your reps on the last set gives you an indication when you're able to move up towards the next set. Similarly, set addition is very particularly useful with pulling exercises. So your pull-ups and rows, if you find yourself getting stuck with 2 to 3 sets, maybe bump up to 4 sets or 5 sets if you need it. And then slide back down to 2 to 3 once you get past your plateau. Usually once you break it, start making progress again and you don't need the elevated sets. You can just drop back, and then if you get stuck again, you can add the sets back in to break through. Likewise, some other progressions that you can use are making sure you get your sets across, such as 8-8-8 or 24 total reps, versus maxing out in the first set, such as 9 reps, and then only getting like 7, 5, or 6 reps on the subsequent sets. 7, 9, and 5 is about 21 reps, so you can see how sets across tends to be a little bit better there. Finally, deloads are more important for trained beginners. Most untrained beginners can progress effectively for usually several months without taking a deload, but fatigue will eventually start to accumulate and catch up with you in the trained beginner phase. So this is when deloads start to become more important, and/or especially if you have connective tissue soreness. Just if you feel lethargic and tend to have more quote unquote bad workouts, more bad workouts than normal, then taking a deload week or few days is a good idea to help to dissipate that extra fatigue and allow your body to get refreshed and heal up from the training and come back stronger, bigger, and ready to progress more, set more PRs. All right, continued progression. So what I said before was that Moving up in progressions, generally speaking, the untrained beginners are going to shift from the basics like your pull-ups, dips, rows, and push-ups into the main goals, such as most people wanting to do, you know, front lever, planche, and so on. So basically, you're going to go towards the specific progression if you have that specific goal, or a movement-based progression to get towards that goal, such as pseudo planche push-ups or tuck front lever rows. And then moving on to the next progression in that line, instead of just working up your push-ups to like one-arm push-ups or your dips towards lean forward dips. The isometric focus, which I mentioned in the untrained beginner section, and all-around strength focus I covered in the exercise sections, but just if you want the quick refresher, there you go with the back lever, front lever, planche, muscle ups, rows, handstand push-ups, the main progressions there if you have a more of an isometric focus. And all-around strength, I like the pseudo planche push-ups, weighted ring dips or ring dips, or weighted dips, ring dips, or handstand push-ups, weighted pull-ups or one-arm chin progression, and one-arm rows or front lever rows progression. All right, finally, getting through this quickly, some of the common modifications that you may encounter in the trained beginner phase are your strength and hypertrophy rep ranges. Mainly going to reduce them from about 5 to 20 down to that 5 to 10, 5 to 12 range. The length of your routine can get much longer in these cases because you may be adding skill work, you may be adding some more isolation work, you may be adding some flexibility work towards the end of your routine. So don't hesitate to shift some of that to off days. Some people with the exercise ADHD like to have things every day, and so shifting some skill work and flexibility, for example, to off days is preferable to them because they're able to do something and it's generally light enough that it is restful and you come back fresh for your full body or split routine the next day. Like I stated before, additional skill work, such as adding time to handstands, this is where you can start to do that. It doesn't necessarily need to be for your workouts. It can be on the off days, as I mentioned before, but usually adding some sets in is necessary to start to work the balance for handstand. Generally, you know, getting 3 to 6 sets of handstand is fine when you're starting to get used to get upside down and it's working the muscles mostly, but as your handstand becomes less about holding yourself upside down, the strength to do it, the endurance to do it, you need more and more sets to work that balance, because balance is the hardest thing to get for most people, especially when locking body straight, tense through the core, the hips, the legs, the feet, gluing them together so you have a locked straight body, and then balancing it mostly with the wrist and forearms. You don't want to be opening, closing the shoulders, arching and piking in the low back and hips and moving your legs, as that tends to negatively affect your sense of getting your balance. It's sort of like standing on one foot and trying to balance with your whole body wobbling back and forth. You can learn to do it that way, but the ideal way, if you're trying to get your ankles muscles working, say like rehab from a sprained ankle or trying to improve your ankle proprioception for, you know, running faster or jogging effectively without any type of injury concerns, you want those ankle muscles to be working. Same with the handstand. You want mainly your wrists and your forearms to be working, not the rest of your body. Generally speaking, this is where you may need to use more of the inter-exercise progressions, especially if you get stuck and plateau. And those common ones are mentioned in Chapter 10, Methods of Progression, but to briefly go over some, basically, you want to make the next exercise easier with bands or a counter pulley weight, or make the previous one harder with a weighted vest or a dip belt or extra weight on you. You can do hybrid sets such as, you know, 1 or 2 reps of the next exercise and then fill in volume with the previous progression, such as doing, say, wide grip pull-ups for 1 to 2 reps if you can only do that many, and then going back to regular pull-ups or L-sit pull-ups as an easier. Wait, L-sit's beyond the white room, but go back to pull-ups to fill in the volume for the wide grip ones after you can only do 1 to 2. Those are the common ones, and then also overuse modifications, working to reduce, substitute, or eliminate the aggravating exercises. So if pull-ups are starting to bother your elbow, sub them out for a couple weeks, or eliminate them, or try to find an alternative, such as going back a progression if that doesn't aggravate your elbows. Deload if necessary, and then if you need some rehab, add in some specific isolation, and ideally see a professional about rehab if you are stuck, and especially if you get stuck. And that's all we got for today. And we'll go into the intermediate progressions next week.